Welcome to another episode of Exploring the Panhandle. I'm your host, Zach McDaniel, and this is Daniel Bontrager, and we're here at Bontrager Whitetails.
Nice to meet you. Appreciate you coming out.
Yes, sir. Tell us a little bit about what you do here.
Well, what we have here is basically two things. We have a hunting preserve, and we also have a deer breeding operation. Our number one focus here is producing big trophy bucks that hunters like to come in and harvest to put the dream buck on the wall that they've always been looking for. The only way you get that is by raising good genetics, good feed, and letting them get old enough to reach their full potential.
Can you tell us a little bit more about your lodge?
Yes, I can. This is one of my favorite things to do with natural wood that comes from our native area. This wood on the front of the lodge is deadhead cypress. This wood may have been in the bottom of the river for 75 to 100 years before it got pulled up. And the beauty of deadhead cypress is that it never rots. You can put it on the outside and you don't have to worry about the elements, like most of our wood does rot if it stays out long enough. Let's go inside and take a look at the lodge.
All right, so tell us what you got going on in here.
Well, this is what I call the great room, and we actually just finished this. This wood that you see in here is poplar. Poplar grows in the creek bottoms right here where we are, and the wood that you see actually on this far wall came from one tree that blew down right when we were putting up our fence, and we drug those logs out, had them cut at a local sawmill. The boards that you see on the newer part, we had those logged out in the spring and took them to a local sawmill and had those cut. And had those planed and tongue and grooved, and we just recently got those up and put a clear on them. But that poplar wood has a very unique grain. It's kind of a soft hardwood, and I've always liked the native trees and all the native plants and everything around about nature, and I just love the poplar wood.
So what's the deal with these big bucks?
These are two of my favorite bucks. This one is Daniel Boone, and this one is Davy Crockett. And these are deer that we have produced here on the farm out of our breeding program. This is the type of look that we want. We want big wide frames, tall tines, and just a few little extra stickers and kickers to give them character. But we still want them to look like a normal deer. Come on in and let's take a look at the living quarters. What we've got here is a common area. Obviously we get kitchen and dining area over here, and in this area we've got the living room. If it ever gets cold in Florida, we're going to light the stove, but we're not sure it's ever going to get cold enough for that. But this is just where everyone hangs out and relaxes while we eat and four times. And of course we've got bucks on the wall that you can look at while you wait in here too. So everywhere you look, we got bucks on the wall.
So how many people can stay here at a time?
Well, we can actually sleep 6 to 8 people quite comfortably because we have 2 bedrooms downstairs and then we have the loft upstairs that has 4 beds. But on our hunts, we prefer to keep it to 1 to 2 hunters. We don't like to crowd it. We like it to be a personal experience, and we just don't like to put people close together.
I noticed you got a couple different types of wood in here. Can you tell us a little bit about them?
Yeah, I can. You know, I told you before I like nature and I like the native things around here. So we have about 5 different kinds of wood in this room. On this wall is juniper, which is very much like cypress. It's a soft wood and easy to work with. On the end wall, we have more poplar. On the far end wall down here, we have southern red cedar. And on the bar here, on the bottom is hickory, which came from a hickory tree that was right on this lot that I cleared before we built the building. And the bar top is wild cherry, which is not really common. The cabinet over here under the TV, which has some unique colorings, is also native hickory. And I like all of them. This is one of my favorite rooms, simply because of the southern red cedar. I love the red color. That's the native true color. That's not a stain or anything. That's what comes from the heart of the southern red cedar. This is a room where we could easily have 2 men, or you could have a father and son, or you could have a mother and daughter. Just a combination room. Take you on through the bathroom. We've made the bathroom handicap accessible with large openings and handrails. All the doors in this room, in the bathrooms and the bedrooms, are 36 inches wide so that we can accommodate wheelchairs or walkers for elderly people that are mobility impaired. And this room shows you the true color of deadhead cypress. We also have a washer and dryer in here in the other bathroom. So if people need to wash their clothes while they're here, if they stay a little longer, that's available too. This pretty much shows you everything that the lodge has. So now we'll go outside and take a look at some deer and see some of the does that are in the breeding operation. All the does have characteristics. Some does are real friendly. Some does are standoffish. Some does don't really have good personalities to be in this breeding facility. So when they're wild and skittish, they're okay as long as they're just here in the pen feeding. But when we go to move them up and down alleys into the barn to do artificial breeding, that can get to be a real challenge. So some of those get moved out into a larger pen and just stay with a buck for live breeding, and they don't actually go through that artificial process. I just moved about four or five does like that just because of that very reason. They just cause problems when we start managing them. Most of these you'll see here would prefer to come eat cookies out of your hand. Come here, mama, come on. But they're not real crazy about strangers. This one's usually up here pulling it out of my hand, you see. But she says, he's got some people with him and I don't know what they're up to. Her name is Red Hot. And her twin sister's name is Red Knot.
Why are they named that?
Well, Red Hot and Red Knot have a sire that was named Red Lion, which was a big, humongous buck in Missouri. And Red Hot was always very nice and friendly, and Red Knot wasn't, so that's why I named them Red Hot and Red Knot. These does are all DNA certified, which means that they have a pedigree that goes five generations deep, most of them, where we know all about their parentage. And after they've been here for 4 or 5 years, we have a pretty good idea of what kind of sons and daughters they produce. Some of them live up to their billing and some of them don't. And that determines where they go and where they stay.
How old do they live to be and still be productive?
Well, some of these does on the property are 11 years old and they've been known to produce fawns up until they're 15 years old. I don't have any that old. Now, most of what you see here are somewhere between 2 and 5 years old. But up till 10, 12 years old, they're very, very productive. It's a little bit like cows. You know, cows live to be 14, 15 years old, and contrary to what a lot of people think about deer, the deer do the same thing.
How long does it take to have fawns once they're bred?
Typically around 196 days. Sometimes some does will come a week early, just like some people do, and some does will come a week to 10 days late. But that's all pretty much in that 196 day range. All five of these does were bottle fed as babies. They've been in the same pen together all their life. They like to be together. They're social animals, and if you move them to another pen, they have to figure out their social pecking order. They have somebody that's the boss and they have somebody that's the one that's picked on. Take a look at some of these fawns. These fawns have just been weaned.
How many fawns did you have this year?
This year in our breeding operation right here on the farm, not those out in the preserve, we tagged 42 fawns. We had 27 buck fawns and the rest were doe fawns. And the ones that you see on the right-hand side were raised by their mamas, and the ones that you see straight ahead were the best of the best genetics of doe fawns that we took from the mamas when they're 24 hours old and fed them by bottle for 3 months. When we start off with the bottle feeding, the very first day or two is four times a day, and then it drops back to 3 times a day for about a month, and then back to 2x a day, and then eventually to 1x a day before weaning. If you see a tag in the right ear, that means it's a buck fawn. If you see a tag in the left ear, it means it's a doe fawn. These babies are going to crowd right up to the fence and compete for the cookies, where these over here on the right hand side are not going to let us get that close.
And why is that?
Well, once you bottle feed these fawns, they get used to people and they lose their fear to some degree. And the ones that have been raised with the mama, they still have the natural instinct to just be afraid of everything. They're afraid of everything that moves.
Do you ever bottle feed buck fawns?
We never, ever bottle feed a buck fawn. The only way that we would ever do that is if we just thought that the buck fawn was absolutely going to die if we didn't bottle feed it. And the reason you don't is you don't want the bucks to be tame by any means. You want them to be wild and natural. And if you bottle feed a buck fawn, and people do this all the time within, you know, just the general communities, they find a fawn that they think has been orphaned. In reality, the mother has probably just left it there waiting to come back and feed it. But if you feed that bottle, if you bottle feed that fawn, when he gets older, he's not afraid of people. And when he goes into rut, he will hurt people. He will try his best to kill people if they get in his way. And not only that, it's totally illegal. Fish and Wildlife Commission strictly prohibits people to take a native deer and feed it and keep it themselves. All these deer are here because we have permits, we're licensed, we're inspected, and it's all very much done by regulation. Hey, baby girls, y'all might have to stay back just a little.
Okay.
They might not let us come up. Come here. Come on. Pretty girl. Yeah, my pretty girl. Come on. Come on, baby girl. Everybody get your cookies. You can do that, girl. Come on. Get your cookies. Come on, girl. There we go. Pretty girl.
So how and why did you start raising deer?
Well, I always loved nature, and so I always loved to hunt. And, you know, in Florida, we never had the kind of hunting that you have in other places. And so you didn't see a whole lot of deer back when we first started. And when I found out that you could actually have a deer and keep it if you got the right permits and you did it all right, it just appealed to me. And we started with one pen and 4 fawns. And the one fawn was a buck fawn. And when he grew his first antlers, he grew a spike on each side that had one little old kicker. There were many deer in the wild that had antlers better than him, which was a huge disappointment. So we just changed. We changed our techniques. We changed the breeding stock. We got better genetics. Then we started artificial breeding. Then when we started artificial breeding, we went to even better does. And then we started breeding laparoscopically, which allows you to split straws of semen. So you can use one straw of semen for multiple does, which cuts down your cost. And it lets you just be much, much more selective with your genetics.
I noticed that you have electric fences around the pens. Can you tell me why?
You have electric fence around the pens to keep the predators out. And the most common predator is a dog. The first really great genetics does that I ever got about 8 years ago, back before there was a ban on importing from other states, I got some really good does from Pennsylvania. And within a month, 2 dogs had dug into the pen and killed 3 out of the 4 does that I had transported in. And in the preserve, the 200 acre pen, the biggest predator is coyotes. So we have a hot wire that goes all the way around 200 acres, 2.5 miles of electric fence, and it pretty much stops the coyotes from digging under the fence. When they see that there's fawns there, they just think it's a buffet. So we put hot wire everywhere, keep that maintained, and that pretty well keeps that under control. Let's take a walk up through here. We've got some bucks up here and some pins that are up on the other end. We'll see if we can get close enough to see something. Fawn was being bottle fed. She was in a group of six. She was the wildest one in the bunch. Did not like to be petted, did not like to be handled. And at some point she decided cookies were worth all that. But she's always standing there in the way. This doe right here prefers to eat them out of the bucket. And she's 11 years old. You'd never know it. This one's only a year and a half old. Because these does produce huge animals. This one right here, 63, is actually Red Knot's daughter. And her sire is a humongous buck named Golden Danger. He actually has antlers that are 33 inches wide. Almost a yardstick. Let's go see some more. Come on, girls. Let's go. Come on. Almost all the pens have alleys between them, and the alleys lead to the handling barn. So when we work animals, we move them down through the alleys to the barn. The other reason you have alleys is if you have bucks in one pen with a group of does, bucks in another pen with a group of does, and you only have one fence between them, they fight through the fence. They'll tear the fence to pieces.
So tell us about these bucks.
This is a pen of yearlings, which means that they're just a little over a year old. That's the first antlers they've ever grown on their head. And you can see the one that's kind of standing there in the front. He's a beautiful big buck, but he's only 1 year old. And that's all about genetics. His mother has great genetics. His sire is a monster, and it just so happened that those DNA chains mesh together, and he'll just get bigger every year if we can keep him alive. And in the South, with all the bugs that we have, the biggest problem that we have with keeping deer alive is a problem called epizootic hemorrhagic disease. It's a disease that's spread by a tiny midge. It's like a no-see-em. And they bite them on the nose and they spread a virus. And as that virus replicates in their system, it sloughs off sharp shards, little like glass-like things that cut them inside and make them bleed. Therefore, it's why it's called hemorrhagic disease. If they bleed enough, then they get secondary bacterial infections, which is usually pneumonia, and that's what ends up killing them. Now here comes this big boy. Come on, pretty boy. His sire is named XL747. And I think he does 747 justice. To be only a year old, that is a beautiful deer. He's got a big wide frame, he's got long tines, he's got a few extras. He's just gonna be big. And in the deer world, bigger is better. Pretty boy. And he has a personality that just is not afraid of me too much, likes to come up and get his cookies. So with a deer like this that's exceptionally bigger than the others, he automatically goes into the breeding rotation. He will go in with a pen of does after they've been artificially bred, because you never get 100% conception on the artificial breeding. And those deer that don't take to the artificial breeding, the backup buck takes care of. And so he'll probably have, in a pen of five or six does, he'll probably have one, hopefully not more than one or two, that he'll breed. Because what we breed with artificially will still be way bigger than he is. But we never know. He may get to be one of those big breeding monsters. When we first started this, I really just intended to have some deer. I didn't intend to breed artificially. I certainly didn't intend to breed surgically, laparoscopically. And as you learn, we do have an association here in Florida called the Southeast Trophy Deer Association. We have seminars, we have veterinarians that treat deer that come and speak to us. I'm also a member of the North American Deer Farmers Association. And that's where you learn a whole lot of this stuff. We have lots of classes there. We have lots of different speakers, veterinarians, genetic specialists, people that USDA has a PhD that comes and talks about the bug control. And you just learn as you go. You lose some animals. We lost one last night. We did a necropsy on one early this morning. And as we speak, it is being delivered to the FedEx Center in Tallahassee. It'll be overnighted to the University of Florida, and they will do major studies on it to determine exactly what killed that animal and what we can do differently to reduce that risk. The green fabric that you see on the pens out around is there to help keep those bugs out. The midge flies very low at about the level of a deer because he's smelling, looking for a blood meal. And that fabric gets sprayed every week to 10 days with a chemical that kills the bugs when they light there. Late this evening, about 30 minutes before dark, we'll come through here with a fogger that sits on a golf cart that looks like a miniature mosquito truck. And right now that runs every day, 7 days a week. We still don't kill them all. Remember we saw Daniel Boone in the lodge? What I didn't tell you right then was that Daniel Boone's not dead. We just took his shed antlers and mounted them on a cape so that we could show them off. And he's right up here. He's a little bit shy with strangers, but he might hang out for us to talk to him. Come on, boys. Come on, boys. Come get a cookie. By nature, they're just not tending to hang around people. But now he's 4 years old. He's been around this process a while. He's had his share of cookies. The one on the right is Daniel Boone. The one on the left is Crab Factor, which all goes back to his genetic name. He's a Max Factor son over a Crab King Doe, so we tie those names into it. Both of those bucks have DNA certificates. And they'll both be in pens with does. Daniel Boone is 4 years old, and Crab Factor there is only 2 years old. He's really a big buck to be too. Talked about the deer being wild by nature. If you see this buck ran off, and if you look down to the far end of the pen, there's two bucks standing as far away from us as they can get. If I was out here by myself, they'd be right up here getting cookies. But they know they're strangers here. And there's another big buck in this far pen over here, and he's not going to show his face. You can't even tell he's out there. He's probably down at the far end, laying in the grass. But these two like to show up.
Do deer have different personalities?
Absolutely. Some of the buck fawns show that when they're 3 months old. They're just not as afraid, and they tend to not be as wild. Some of the bucks that have been in here before were just so wild that they kept everything else just crazy wild, and those that aren't really suited to be in a small pen, most of those either get sold as a breeder to a bigger place, or either they get turned out into the preserve.
So how long have you been doing this?
We actually got the first four fawns in 2005. So we've been at it 11 years now, and the quality has gone up every year. Each year's breeding produces a little bit higher quality genetics. Sometimes some of those best genetics die just from diseases and things like that. And sometimes you just produce great big monsters that make it all worthwhile. But I could come out here and sit down on a bucket and talk to these babies and throw them cookies for hours at a time, because it's just one of those simple pleasures of life that only farmers can really relate to.
Are there any bushes out here that are poisonous to the deer?
Not that I know of. There may be, and I don't know it. The one thing I do know is that poison ivy, which, you know, obviously bothers people a lot, that animals eat poison ivy, and it doesn't bother. The deer will eat poison ivy, and it's not a problem. I don't know that he really likes it or prefers it, but it's just not the same to them that it is to us.
When did the bucks rut in this preserve?
That's an interesting question that a lot of people want to know, because typically the native deer in this part of the country will rut in January, late January or early February. But because we have so much northern bloodline in our deer, most of our rutting activity will start the first part of November and usually be done by about Thanksgiving. Some of the deer will rut a little bit later. Got to get rid of that Zika virus there. And it totally blows people away, because it's a whole different time frame in the same region, which is supposedly controlled by the hours of daylight. But we definitely see that the genetic strains make a difference as to when they rut. See that tree, how it's all skinned off right there? That's once the buck sheds their velvet, they start working their antlers. And what they're really doing is they're working out. They're building up their neck muscles. They push against it, and they just skin the bark off the tree. So you can see right there that that's very active and very fresh. That's where the bucks have been working, just trying to get ready for the rut. This is one of our primary hunting blinds. I made it big so that we could put 3 or 4 or 5 people in it. We actually had a grandfather and his son-in-law and his grandson in here one time on a hunt. And we have room for video stands. And obviously it's all about safety. We've got stairways, the pen rails. So you see Zach is sitting in the driver's seat here. If we were on a hunt, we'd slide the window open. Feeders are off to the right. There'll be winter crops out here in the wintertime, and we'll sit and watch for that perfect trophy that he's been dreaming about all his life that he's never seen before. So we make those dreams come true right here. So we enjoyed you coming out today. Appreciate you taking the time to look around. You know, we have a small family operation here. Our whole focus is personalized attention, preferably one-on-one hunts, making sure that each and every person is 100% satisfied. There's no pressure. It's all just a relaxed atmosphere. Got a great place to stay, good food to eat. We can make you have your ultimate whitetail hunt dream come true right here in Jackson County.
All right. Thank you, Daniel. It's been a pleasure. Thank you for letting us come out here and explore Bontrager Whitetails. It has been a unique experience for, you know, all of us. So I've learned a lot. I'm sure our viewers have learned a lot. And we'll see you next time on Exploring the Panhandle.